at the time, long before Spindletop ever came, there was a Sour Lake in the Sour Lakes. Now, there's a lot of history here. Hey, this is a cool book. It is just now coming out, and it's called Spindletop, The Untold Story. And this is Christine Moore Sanders, whose relatives were directly involved in what happened here. She is, as I remember this, and I haven't read this, but I believe she was related to Captain O'Brien, George O'Brien, who was directly involved. And she kind of tells a different story. And there are a lot of stories out there about what happened on this day in 1901. There's Gladys. And this is the original, one of the original shares of the Gladys City Oil and Gas Manufacturing Company. Involved in this organization were a lot of people, not only Patilla Higgins, but also Lucas and also Carroll and McFadden, all these names you've heard before, haven't you?
Yes.
Because their streets, their buildings, their schools, and that's why, because they were part of the history of this era and then of this town in a very major part, in a very big way. 41 degrees out, as we mentioned this morning, so if you're coming out here, you might, want to slip on a jacket.
Do slip on a jacket, a heavy one too, because the wind is the one that's going to really be a factor for today. The wind chill factor feels like 22, 28 degrees outside.
Just looking over our shoulder, we're on a platform so we can kind of look over the top of everyone. Good crowd beginning to file in this morning. If you're making your way out here, remember, park at one of the designated areas and then grab a shuttle. You'll be over here lickety-split. We're talking about 9:32, they're going to start. Lickety-split. That was an expression they used in 1901.
Yeah, I understand.
And at 10:32, the gusher or the geyser will actually happen. More live coverage coming up of Spindletop 2001 right here on KFDM-TV.
Dr. Singla and the physicians of Southeast Texas Laser Eye Institute can help you regain your sight starting as low as $9.99 per eye. LASIK correction has never been so affordable. Your first visit is free. Patients from around the country travel to Port Arthur to receive the best care available with the most advanced FDA lasers in the world. If poor sight has plagued you your entire life, make a commitment. Take advantage of this limited offer today. Throw away your glasses and see exactly what you've been missing. Call Southeast Texas Laser Eye Institute today. 1-877-40-LASIK.
You're watching KFDM, special live coverage of the Spindletop 2001 Centennial Celebration. And now, back to the big day.
Hi, everybody. You're looking at live pictures from Spindletop Gladys City, the museum. Here on the campus of Lamar University, and some very interesting photographs there. We talked about technology, and Tom was explaining that so many of these things had never happened before. You were looking at what they considered to be a big well in 1901, before January of 1901, 5,000 barrels a day. You're talking about 190,000 barrels of oil. All right, we're talking about lakes of oil, and they didn't know what to do with it. How do you store it? What do you do with it? That was one of the biggest discussions for the first week after the gusher Lucas number one came in, is what do we do with all this oil? And eventually they brought what they called scrapers out. I wanted to show you that. It's a great timing, guys. They brought out what they called scrapers. You know, at the time in 1901, you didn't have heavy machinery. You didn't have backhoes. You didn't have front end loaders. They had to bring the horses out with what they called scrapers and build these mounds and levees, and they actually built these lakes of oil. Can you imagine what happens if somebody throws a cigarette into one of these? They actually had signs up everywhere. Oil is flammable. Oil can get, nobody knew. They really didn't know how to deal with this. But the tanks that you saw just a few minutes ago were another example. They said, what are we gonna do? Well, we'll just store it on site. So they started building these. And there's another whole industry
right. That
was created to, and they still exist today, by the way. There are some of the original tanks that were built in 1901 are still standing today on the south side of Cardinal Drive over here. In some of these fields, there are still some of the original tanks from 1901 that they built. That's how well-crafted they were, and they were made out of iron.
Yeah.
I mean, big rivets, you know, into these things. And, of course, from this, you have all the refineries that popped up across Southeast Texas. Out of this one event, you have Mobile, you had Gulf, you had Texaco, you had Shell.
Sun.
All started right here in Southeast Texas and really built what today, of course, are the mega oil companies of the world. And they don't, of course, what the technology they learned here quickly spread around the rest of the country and became commonplace in cities like Batson. Batson was a huge oil field at its time, which came in, I think, about a year after after they started drilling here. Then they went to Batson, maybe perhaps a little bit later than that. Lots of history to be told on this day.
And some of the history, you know, back 100 years ago, I just found this out this morning, that women, I'm probably going to get in trouble for this, but women 100 years ago only washed their hair once a month. And they used either borax or egg yolks to do that. Just wanted to
I'm glad share you that. Shared that.
That's
I'm
history, brother. That's it.
I agree.
That's all I'm saying is it's history. It's a part of history.
And if you wanted to take a bath, I mean, think about it. If you wanted to take a bath, you had to boil the water. You didn't just go, oh, I'm going to go, you know, and take a hot bath.
No,
you had to boil the water, bring it inside, that sort of. Hey, there's a look at some of the folks who are filing in, and we're expecting thousands to turn out for the reenactment. But that's just one of the many events that's going on today. We have the reenactment coming up at 10:32, but we also have, Randall, can we see the map? Because we'll show folks. We have a whole area that is reserved for kids and kids' activities that is across the street. Across University, which is closed today. There's no traffic on University, so you can freely walk between the two areas. You can kind of mill about. A lot of people still standing around now, waiting for the official beginning of the ceremonies. But Jackie Simeon is over in the children's Boomtown today, where she is tracking some of the kids. And Tom Wright is over in Gladys City, where living history is going on. So if you've ever wondered, you know, what it was like, what these people did, what was the occupation, I think they have soap makers.
Yeah.
They have people who are actually over there doing their wash today.
Well, that's a good day to do the wash, you know.
Well, you know, you ever heard the expression, too many irons in the fire?
Yeah.
Well, that was born out of this time period.
The blacksmith shop is banging open.
Yeah, when you actually had irons, you had to put them in the fire. And you had to juggle which one to use so that you could get all your washing done. You might have too many irons in the fire to take care of all those. Now, just a tidbit of information, and
we're full of it today.
Well, we're full of it every day, but today we're full of history information.
That's what I was talking about, history.
All right, so 4 minutes past the hour.
You know, by the way, I just wanted to, speaking of history, 100 years ago on this date, you know, Old Glory, which has 50 stars, only had 45 back then. Can you name the five states that weren't on Old Glory's flag?
I see Alaska would have to be one of them.
Yeah.
Hawaii would have to be one
That's
of
true.
Them.
That's true.
Gosh.
Three more. I'll give you a hint.
Okay.
Arizona.
New Mexico, maybe.
New Mexico.
Utah.
And Oklahoma. Yeah.
Okay.
Those five states were not on. Are part of the United States.
All right, Tom Wright, as we mentioned, is with the live reenactors over in Gladys City. And Tom, one of the folks directly involved, as we mentioned all morning, were three brothers named Hamill, who by the time they got here and really got started, I think it was down to just two brothers named Hamill, right?
Right. The two of them came over, and I think the other one stayed in Corsicana to take care of the business there. We have Kurt Hamill with us, and Mr. Hamill, you've been drilling out here for a few months now.
Yes, sir.
And how's it going?
Well, we've had a lot of problems. We're optimistic. We keep hitting a lot of sand. It's jamming up our pipe. We've had to abandon a lot of our pipe, go to smaller diameters, but we're trying mud instead of water now to flush the pipes.
Now, I understand this is a new innovation, that prior to this you've just used water, but due to some circumstances you use some muddy water, and that's working out.
Yes, sir. It was a really kind of an accident. The water isn't heavy enough to carry the sand up out of the well hole, but we had some cattle got into our sludge pit, kind of muddied it up, and the mud had a consistency where it worked a lot better. So we're making some progress.
So this is something we might call drilling mud.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. In the future, it probably will be called drilling mud.
Do you have any idea when you might actually strike oil?
Well, sir, we've gotten some indications. Last night, we had a glowing over the well, St. Elmo's fire. I'm not sure exactly what caused it, but we're thinking it might have something to do with some gas coming out of the hole. We're taking that as an indication things are looking up.
Well, if you were to strike oil, what would you expect to happen?
Well, it would depend on how much oil we hit. we would expect that it would start, it should have enough pressure to come up out of the hole, we hope.
That's all you hope for, enough pressure just for it to, you don't have to pump it out.
Yes, sir.
All right, well, good luck to you, Kurt.
Thank you very
much. We'll see how this plays out. Of course, we know that story was a little different. They expected it maybe just to come up by itself, and that's what they hoped for. They got a whole different story. I mean, you have this geyser of oil that came out that no one had seen that before. They had reports of these in Russia. In fact, Russia was the leading oil producer in the world at the time. But by the time they drilled three wells on Spindletop, the United States became the leading oil producing country. So it shows you the sort of the volume that had never been seen before. Of course, later on there were much bigger fields discovered, and Spindletop pales in comparison to what we found later. But you have to take it in the context of the day that when they saw this amount of oil, it blew people's minds. I don't know how else to say it. But Kurt Hamill, of course, expecting, you know, just maybe a little seepage coming out. Different story when it actually happened, Dan.
All right, thanks, Tom. And again, we'll continue to check in with the live reenactors, the history folks in Gladys City.
They're waiting for the gusher, aren't they?
They are, and yeah. All the folks are waiting for the gusher right here as well. As you can see, the crowd's beginning to come up behind us now, and as they
You know, I just looked up moments ago, and it wasn't, you know, about half this. You look back, and then all of a sudden, you go, wow, look at all the people.
Why, smart people have on those ponchos down there, because I think we're going to get wet before this is all over. 8 minutes past the hour. Let's take a break. We'll come back and continue our live coverage from the Spindletop Gladys City as Spindletop 2001 is well underway.
Attention Beaumont and surrounding area. This is a public notice. Royal Furniture is conducting the biggest loss to lease sale in the history of the city. Everything must go. Start the new year right with the new furniture you've always wanted. After 30 years of serving Louisiana, our warehouses are full and we're liquidating all inventory through the new Beaumont store. No reasonable offer will be refused during Royal Furniture's public loss to lease liquidation sale. Everything must be sold. Living rooms, bedrooms, dining rooms, bedding, and dinettes. The selection is huge, so come to Royal Furniture today at 10 a.m.
As we join to celebrate Spindletop's glorious past, we're exploring its future. We are Centennial Oil and Gas Investments, and we hope to develop new oil and natural gas wells in the historic Spindletop Dome area. Early exploration relied greatly on determination and instinct. We now have generations of experience and technology to help us. Methods like 3D seismic surveying through sound waves. Can Spindletop make history again? Centennial is working on it.
At Southeast Texas Laser Eye Institute, Dr. Singla's team of qualified physicians can eliminate your need for contacts or glasses in less than 30 minutes. Our staff has mastered the LASIK procedure, which has become routine with the use of FDA lasers. Finally, you can toss your glasses or contacts away. First consultation is free. Evening and Saturday appointments are available. Starting as low as $9.99 per eye, LASIK has never been more affordable. LASIK. Give it to yourself or someone you love. Call Southeast Texas Laser Eye Institute today. 1-877-40-LASIK.
Hour of 9 o'clock. Hi, everybody. Dan Gresham along with our crew this morning that is, numbering well into the dozens, if you will, from Channel 6. We have a lot of our folks who are out manning cameras who have braved the cold this morning, and it has been cold. Also, James is out with us, James Brown. We have Bill Leger is roaming the grounds this morning. Also, Jackie Simeon over in the children's area. Plus, of course, Larry Beaulieu is here. I believe Larry is going to act as one of the masters of ceremony today, and he'll actually be introducing some of the folks who are on the platform this morning, including the former president of the United States will be here. That's right, George Bush is on the committee and has been from the beginning for Spindletop 2001.
Thank you.
And we have a glove on fire here in the... fire.
Thank you. Everybody wants to give me their gloves.
I don't blame
anyway.
Them. Yeah, give him a toboggan for his head instead of the gloves.
Yeah, everybody wants to bring me their gloves. No, thank you anyway.
So I told him, I said, you know, real men wear gloves.
And real stupid men are without gloves.
But we are well prepared, and if you're coming out, we want you to be too. If you'll just take a couple of minutes to get dressed, if you layer to come out, and there's still plenty of time. Real quickly, a friend of ours, Jerry Newman, is here, who is a professor from Lamar University. And Jerry, just come on up if you get a chance. Kind of avoid the heater there, if you will. We don't want to melt your item. If you'll hold
that. Sure, you bet.
Jerry, if you'll just plop down there for just a second, I want to show you something that Jerry has.
We can fix that.
Has done here.
This is a crowd's rolling in.
Jerry has been on the faculty at Lamar University for years, and most folks will know him for his florals and for his watercolors. But this one you did specifically for the day?
For today. Yeah, it's been working on it for about a year.
Are these just
prints right here? But I had to do the research on it, find out what happened, and get into the library and so forth.
Were you
this
surprised
has a lot of hits
at what
let
you
me hold
found,
that.
I mean, when you went and started doing the research?
Right.
Let me hold those for you.
Okay.
We'll let James take care of it. So what do we see on that? What are the different, because it's what, four or five different scenes, right?
Right. Well, there's an old Model A car there stuck in the mud. This mule down in the lower right-hand corner was kind of interesting to me. I was born in Pennington, Texas, near Crockett, on a farm, and my grandmother was the doctor. And when I got up to about 6 or 7 years old, I did some plowing and so forth. My granddaddy would help me hook up the mule. And when I was looking at the photograph of this, there's leather hanging down across the eyes of the mule. And that was so he could shake his head and make the mosquitoes and flies get out of his eyes.
Oh, is that what that, okay.
And then also over on the other side, you kind of put in a shot of Gladys City or some of the Boomtown there,
right,
as well.
Up in the corner there, you got one of those stump guys in there probably trying to get them to buy some oil or.
Oh, you got a promoter over there on the corner there.
Waiting on sitting around on the porch and so forth.
I read an interesting statistic yesterday that something like $200 million traded hands. In this city over the course of like 24 months.
Really?
That's amazing, $200 million. Now, you got another one behind it there.
Right.
Another print that you've done for
right.
the occasion?
This building right here, I was coming back from Austin about 2 months ago, and somebody had painted the Texas flag on the side of that building, and it just hit me. And I got back to my studio and I painted that on there and then put an oil rig in the front and I call it one in every yard.
One in every yard. You gotta love it. Jerry, thanks for your time. We appreciate it. And these prints are available if you want to pick one up, you know, to keep a souvenir. And there are lots of souvenirs out there, James Brown.
And lots of food, too.
Yep, that's
in the
true.
Food court.
And the best way to find out about what's happening on the other side of the street is to check in with Jackie Simeon. Good morning, Jackie.
Good morning, Dan. Once again, we're here not at the Children's Activity Center. A lot of the children have moved across the street to right in front of the Gusher replica, in front of the center stage where all the activities will begin when the program starts in just a bit. And we have so many kids representing so many different Southeast Texas schools here with us. Over here, we have students from Koontz. Right behind me, we have students from Central in Beaumont. We have Bridge City represented. And we also have students from Hillcrest Elementary School. And if you walk around, you'll find that a lot of kids came out here with their parents. And just because it's a day off from school doesn't mean that it has to be a day off from learning. A lot of parents are out here with their families to learn a little bit more about the history of Spindletop and the city of Beaumont. With me right now is the Gabriel family, and they came all the way down from Port Arthur, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Why don't you introduce yourself and your sons here?
My name is Deborah Gabriel. This is my son, Jeremy Gabriel. And this is my son, Jeremiah Gabriel. And we're from Port Arthur.
All right. Tell us some of the activities you've taken part in already this morning. What are some of the things you've seen and done?
We've been to the museum, the rooms, the barbershop, seen them making a fire with the old-time fire thing or whatever you call it. And that's about it.
All right. What are y'all looking forward to doing most today?
Going to the Children's Activity Center and go and watch George Bush's daddy, the former president, talk and watch the Gusher.
All right, what are you looking forward to most?
The same thing he said, I'm gonna watch George Bush and I'm gonna watch the Spindletop Gusher.
So lots of excitement out here for the kids. The kids are looking forward to a lot of the activities as much as the adults out here. And notice how he referred to our former president. He's George W. Bush's daddy to the younger people out here, and not necessarily remembered as the president as most of the adults out here would remember him. Dan?
All right, thank you, Jackie. And as we mentioned, the crowd just continues to grow here at Gladys City, and we have all kinds of folks that are shouting. We have a unique situation here. We're up on the top of a platform, so we can look out over the crowd, and they have a chance. Just a minute. This is interesting. Somebody just brought this by, and I want to show this. Yeah, sure. Just explain, this is a bus token?
That is the original bus token from Beaumont that was used back in the early days.
Turn this way so we can see who you are. Who are you?
I'm Pat Ashmore.
Hello, Pat.
Hi, we have a business. It's called Money Now and Then.
Uh-huh.
And we watch your program every day, and we thought this would make it complete.
Well, that is
that cool?
That is really neat.
That is a bus token.
That is a bus token that was used in the early days.
And of course, for those who don't know, we had trolleys that ran here in Beaumont shortly. In fact, in 1901, they were running trolleys here. Thanks for bringing that by. It's a pleasure to meet you.
Thank you so much.
These are very kind.
Yeah, and you know, the funny part about it was that the hottest saying back in 1901, 100 years ago, was, yeah, giddy up.
That was it.
That was
the catchphrase.
But you got to do it like that.
Oh.
Yeah, you gotta go, yeah! Say it.
I don't think I have the hang of it yet.
Oh,
could
well.
You do it a couple more times?
Yeah, I'll teach you later.
All right.
Giddy up!
I got that part. It is 18 minutes past 9 o'clock. And if you're on your way out here, don't stop. You can make it on out here, park at any of the different locations. It's kind of a park and ride situation. They have shuttles going from the various locations.
You know, which is a very smart thing to do, because if you tried to get all the folks that were coming out here and bringing their cars and carpooling, there would be no way you could do it. So that was a very smart move to actually park somewhere else, shuttle ride. That'll get you to and from a lot faster than you could do it yourself.
Absolutely. And we talked about some of the folks who are going to be here. And there's a look at the map. If you haven't been out here, it's an activities map, basically. It's just to show you, if you come out and you park and ride, that there are things going on both sides of the street. Not only will there be the reenactment of the gusher in just a few minutes, James is inciting the crowd, I think.
You know, let's see. These are school kids. They said they watch our show every morning, and they're yelling at us.
And that's one of the helicopters. I think that's the Sheriff's Department and also KHOU. So there's interest from Houston to come over and cover this event. And I think one of our guests mentioned earlier this morning that newspaper coverage of this event has been pretty incredible, with the New Orleans paper had a great article. I was in near Dallas. There was a big article in the Dallas Morning News up there, and of course the Chronicle did one. Richard Stewart, who is the correspondent here in Beaumont, and the same thing happened in 1901. Newspapers from all over the country sent their correspondents to Southeast Texas to encounter what they thought would be this small town, and they get here and find out it's bustling. I mean, the Boomtown era of Spindletop is quite an amazing story all in itself. And if we have some time this morning, we'll talk about that. It's running up on about 20 minutes past 9 o'clock as we continue with our live coverage from the Spindletop Gladys City on the campus of Lamar University. We'll be back with more right after this.
It only takes a minute to correct a lifetime of dependence on glasses or contacts. The procedure is called LASIK. It's becoming the preferred method of treatment for nearsightedness and astigmatism. The Southeast Texas Laser Eye Institute has the latest technology in laser vision correction. LASIK is very accurate, quick, virtually painless, and results are almost immediate. Call 1-877-40-LASIK to find out if LASIK's right for you. The Southeast Texas Laser Eye Institute. Vision by laser.
As we join to celebrate Spindletop's glorious past, we're exploring its future. We are Centennial Oil and Gas Investments, and we hope to develop new oil and natural gas wells in the historic Spindletop Dome area. Early exploration relied greatly on determination and instinct. We now have generations of experience and technology to help us, methods like 3D seismic surveying through sound waves. Can Spindletop make history again? Centennial is working on it.
I got rear-ended in my car wreck. I was at a stop sign. I smashed my leg. I needed therapy. The insurance company turned me down flat. I called Jim Adler. He got me $175,000. Unbelievable.
Look at me. I'm Jim Adler, the Texas Hammer. $175,000. That's a lot of money. I will battle everyone to blame for every dollar you deserve for your car crash.
409-835-5700.
Mr. Adler, thank you.
Somebody's going up one of the derricks in the back, one of the reenactors. Did you know by 1902 there were 285 active wells on Spindletop Hill? Over 600 oil companies are chartered. Among them, the Texas Company, which became Texaco, of course. The Guffey Petroleum Company, which became
Gulf.
Absolutely. The Magnolia Petroleum Company.
Yeah, was that Mobil Oil?
Very good. That was Mobil and Sun Oil. But the amazing thing that a lot of people don't realize is that within 2 years, it was over. I mean, they had pretty much played out the field. It was depleted by that time.
Yeah, they overtapped it, didn't they?
Yeah, and within 10 years, Spindletop or Gladys City was a ghost town within 10 years. So, I mean, when it happened, it was a flurry of activity. It happened very quickly, and there were a lot of trades made. There's a great story, and Tom Wright knows this one, too, about the guy who was out of town when the Lucas Gusher came in. And he was out for like a week, and his farm was located right over here. His property was adjacent to the hill. And he had paid something like, $50 an acre or something. Well, when he rode back into town, before he even got into town, somebody offered him $20,000 for his farm. Well, he couldn't believe it, so automatically he said, absolutely, you know, sold. And they made the transaction right there. By the time he got to his home, there was somebody waiting there at the farm, offered him $50,000. And then it was a short time later, they actually sold that same property for $100,000.
And 100 years ago, $100,000, it'd be like $1 billion to you and me.
It was more money than they could spend in their lifetime.
You know, 100 years ago, they hadn't invented Scotch tape.
No.
They hadn't had plutonium, insulin, antibiotics. None of that was invented yet. Canned beer, iced tea, none of that you could get. None of that
was
going on.
No, they had to drink their beer out of the tap. You're right, James. They had no cans.
Well, I'm just saying that that's
but they had lots of saloons to do it in, let me tell you.
Yeah.
That was a bawdy place.
Including the Log Cabin Saloon
right
here.
That's right, which is part of the buildings that are inside the Gladys City Spindletop, or Boomtown Museum. And speaking of which, Tom Wright is standing by this morning, giving us some live insight into the history of Southeast Texas. Tom, what you got over there?
Well, a crowd picking up out here. We're at Broussard's Livery Stable. If you don't know what a livery stable is, well, that was a place that had wagons, that was your trucking industry, so to speak. But an interesting transformation took place in a lot of livery stations, livery stables around the country. And you might notice this is Broussard's Livery Stable, and this fellow's name is Jim Broussard. You might say, well, Broussard's, I know that as being the mortuary in town. Very direct connection between those two businesses, isn't there?
Yes, there is.
one became the other.
Certainly.
Why did that happen? We have a livery stable responsible for trucking goods and that sort of thing. How does that transform into the mortuary business?
Well, we were in the transportation business. We were providing loggers up and down the river with teams of draft horses and mules, transportation, the hitches for the streetcars in the city of Beaumont, ambulance service. And when special events came, deaths, weddings, they looked to the liveryman for their livestock. And as we provided that and the population swelled in our area, a lot of that had to do with the growth of the logging industry along the river and then eventually Spindletop. The population sustained itself and we began offering other services, use of carriages and vehicles, a hearse. And then here we are, you know, 100 years later.
Pretty interesting transformation. Tell us about this piece back here. When does this date from?
This hearse was built in Chicago, Illinois in 1885. And we don't have a real good idea when it was introduced into our family. Kind of went into hibernation for a number of years, and we brought it back out. but it's truly has never been restored. It's been refinished once, and that was in, I believe, 1958. Wonderfully built piece of equipment, and was a rural funeral coach because of the iron wheel. Just a great piece.
Now, let me make sure I have the ancestry right. Was it Alex Broussard, and he would be your...
Great-grandfather.
Okay. Yeah. So you've had a few generations come along.
Yeah,
so.
And very excited. My son's working with us in our company now, which would be five generations if he follows through with it. And it's just great.
And I understand the mustache runs in the family, right?
Yeah.
All right, thanks a lot. Jim Broussard, interesting story there. You know, you have these businesses that have been around for a long time, and when that... Spindletop, when that boom hit and they had to move goods and get equipment out to the fields, where Broussard's livery stable was involved in that, as you mentioned, but they started offering some other services and became a mortuary. And you know, there's a lot of those kinds of stories, a lot of these businesses that trace their roots back to that time period, Dan. So one of the many great stories you can get, you come out here and talk to these folks here all day long, Gladys City, Boomtown Museum.
And you know what, Tom? The five leading causes of death in 1901 was pneumonia and the flu. When you caught the flu, that was one of the leading causes of death. Also tuberculosis, diarrhea, heart disease, and stroke. Those are the five leading causes of death 100 years ago.
Wow.
Yeah.
And you know, you can relate that, Tom, to some of the
gunfighting or something would have been.
Well, but you know, people, I think, have the misconception about what was happening at the turn of the century. I mean, we were moving into a new era already. Yeah. You know, we were already going to a new place. But it happened in Beaumont that the water was not exactly the best, all right? There were things that were, by the time
you
the boom came...
You mean the Natchez River?
One of the people who visited the city said it had a definite smell of fish, alligators, and lizards. And it gave a lot of these people, of course, dysentery and, as you mentioned, diarrhea, to be quite blunt.
Yeah.
And when you got that and you got sick, they would say you had a case of the Beaumonts.
Oh, really?
Yeah. They'd say you have a case of the Beaumonts. It was a very popular saying.
And, I'm glad that went out of date.
They had some very enterprising kids back then. What they would do is they would sell water to people who actually had to stand in line to use the facilities. Because you're talking about 50,000 people in a city that was made for 9,000. They didn't have beds. They didn't have baths. The barbers were making $200 a day, giving shaves and renting out their chairs for people to sleep. I mean, that's just one of the facts of life when you live in a boomtown.
Yeah, and you know, without running water back then, 100 years ago, the doctors went to medical school back then and graduated from a medical school, which was condemned, by the way, a few years later. They washed their hands, not under running water, but in bowls, you know, of stagnated water, and they were just passed the germs along to patient after patient.
I don't want to think about all these germs
like wildfire. That was 100 years ago. Well, and remember, antibiotics wasn't created yet.
Right, so our lives have certainly changed over the last 100 years, that's for sure. And that's one of the reasons that we're out here today, as we've told you all morning long, really two reasons. One is to share the history of the time, the day, and of our particular area in which we live. And the other is to help you get out here if you want to be here live and be part of it. We know, of course, at 10:32 that we're going to shoot the geyser off in the replica of the Lucas number 1. But they're also going to do it again this afternoon at 3:02. So if you can't get out this morning, you can come back this afternoon. Many of the same activities will be going on. And in fact, they will not end until about 4 o'clock this afternoon. And then tonight at 6 o'clock, they have a very big banquet coming up, which is the Spindletop Bash, the gala, that will take place in the Beaumont Civic Center, and a lot of dignitaries will be there, including former Senator Bill Bradley will be there, who also, of course, ran for president. And he will be there, and he will be the keynote speaker coming up this evening.
Yeah, and you know, it's not just about the Lucas Gusher exploding into the air or anything, the replica, that's a big part of today. But there's also, you know, I know Tracy Bird's out here, Mark Chestnut is out here today. There's going to be live music, live entertainment. We have food courts across the
way.
That's true. Arts and crafts, all kinds of knickknacks, hot coffee, hot chocolate, you name it. It's out here at Spindletop 2001 celebration. This is a big day for Beaumont.
It's a very big day for Beaumont. Randall, do we have some more of those pictures? Because we've been talking about what happened in 1901 and the fact that, you know, the gusher came in and what it did. But I was reading this morning that people are kind of mistaken when they think that There was not much here prior to the Lucas Gusher. In fact, I read this morning where that Beaumont, because of the railroads, had this phenomenal growth. In fact, the population doubled from 5 to 10,000 during the 1890s before the Gusher ever came in. And of course, the number one industry at the time was the timber industry. We had cattle and timber. But prior to this,
Sabine Pass had to be in there somewhere because that is an older city.
It was a deep water port, and it certainly was there before Port Arthur was there. Port Arthur really got its growth basically out of what came after Spindletop. I mean, the city was there, but it really boomed once they started a pipeline from Gladys City down to Port Arthur, and they built the first refineries. But did you know, for example, large-scale lumbering began in 1876. We had six sawmills that lined the Natchez. Their daily capacity was 240,000 feet of rough lumber, 200,000 feet of dress lumber, 200,000 shingles a day, and 24,000 fence pickets were made in a single day. And of course, as you can see, they then converted the lumber into derricks, which were used. All that lumber had to be shipped in from the forest, of course, the big pine forest, and the big thicket in that area, down to Beaumont, where they built these 60-foot tall derricks. Look at the size of the timbers that they used.
So you had craftspeople that had to come in, not just oil people, but you had to have craftspersons to do the building, the carpentry work, the metal work, the pipe work, pipe fitters, and, I guess...
created industry, and that's why all these people came. Not all of them were roustabouts. Many of them were carpenters that came to help build the derricks, and Tom Wright knows as well as anyone because he's over there with a lot of the folks who are helping to reenact that very idea, some of the different things that were happening on this day in 1901. Tom?
Well, I saw this group over here of proper towns ladies all decked out, so I had to find out what this was all about. And careful. Now, who is the group here?
We're Beaumont Musical Review. We're Perspective, Sweet Adeline Chorus.
So you're going to be performing out here today?
Yes, we are.
Well, you all look great.
Oh, thank you.
Now, is this something, this little something you had hanging in the closet?
Yes. Yes.
Somehow I believe it's a little more difficult
than
that.
The hair.
Well, you got the hats and the shawls and the beautiful dresses, so...
And the long underwear.
Is that period pieces? Definitely. They do, see, they really do have the long underwear. Look at those shoes, that's great. Let's see the shoes, everybody. Oh, look at that. No, she got the bun on the back of the hat. Well, you guys did great. And so a little later, what time are you performing, do you know?
11:30. We will open the entertainment section just with, a couple little songs.
Well, great. Period songs? Or?
Very much so.
Okay, great. Yes. We'll look forward to that then. Thank you very much, and have
a
great day out here.
I want you to look at my boys.
Oh, well, let's look at the look at you. Got your knickers on,
and
don't you?
Joshua over here.
Yeah, you're not going to run around school like that, are you?
Sure.
No, you guys look great. You look great. Look at this young man here, too. Y'all look great. Got the bow tie on.
Yeah.
Look, got the hat. Do you feel 1901?
Yes.
Yeah, all right. All right, Dan. Well, they've gone all out here. They figure if they're going to be here, they might as well, dress the part. So they look great. And, again, going to be one of the many people who are going to be performing out here today because we have a string band over here. We have a lot of musical talent as well as the living history. So if you come out here, there's something going on all day long till 3:30, so take advantage of it.
You know, I mentioned that, Tom, and we probably want to point that again, that it doesn't end once the reenactment starts with the geyser, that it's just going to continue right on through the day, right?
Rain or shine.
Absolutely. Not only does it continue on through the day, but there's going to be a second reenactment that will happen at about 3 o'clock, but the program starting at 2:30, and then at 3 they'll do a second showing of it. So if you haven't made it out here this morning, and you can get out here this afternoon, you get to see it again. So we're going to show you to you live on TV at 10:30, and then if you say, boy, it looks pretty good and want to see it in person, you can come out here, come early, come to Gladys City here and see the living history display, some of the musical talent, that sort of thing, and make a day of it.
Yeah, I think it's a great idea. If you can do that, all right, it's 36 minutes past the hour. We mentioned previously the former President George Bush, the father, of course. Do you think he likes being referred to as the father?
I think he's very proud.
Oh, I'm sure he is.
Sure.
I'm sure that. Mm-hmm. All right, and as we mentioned, he will be coming in, and we're going to have him arriving shortly. Larry is up on the podium right now. Larry Beaulieu, our general manager at Channel 6. He is acting as the master of ceremonies, and And even the sun is trying to peek through. Visitors. Just a little bit this morning as we look up there. You know, we were talking about rain and, oh, it's, you know, it's cold. But not yet. We haven't had any rain to speak of here at Gladys City.
No, but Randy, I was wondering if you wouldn't mind taking a look at live Doppler radar, because I know that there's been rain in Central Texas, and we've had some drizzle around there, but you can see there are some showers popping up
along Interstate 45 in Houston. The rest of that stuff you see over in Louisiana, that's not going to affect us as it's moving off to the east, northeast. And the stuff in the lakes area, well, there's a little bit of light drizzle going on in that direction. But again, we could see some drizzle going on before noon.
Right now, we haven't had a drop. Like you said, Dan, we've been very fortunate so far this morning as the rain has stayed away from Gladys City for the time being. But later tonight, yeah, you might want to keep in mind that we could have not only some heavy rainfall possible.
There's the former president, George Bush, right there as he makes his way onto the grounds.
Yeah.
Limping a little bit. As a matter of fact, I saw him the other day. He had a cane.
He just had hip surgery.
Yeah, had some surgery. And we're glad to have him here today. And as we understand it, and our plan at this point, our game plan is that once they begin the official ceremony up on the platform, we will take you up there and we'll have the introduction of all the VIPs. And then I believe that Michael Halbooty, who is this great character, if you've never met the man, he's 91 years old. He was actually here during what they call the second boom of Spindletop, which was the yacht era.
1926, 1927.
When they actually, what happened was the technology changed and the ability to go even deeper and even use some different drilling technology and pressures to be able to force the oil from deeper levels back up created a second boom. And Frank Yount and the Yount Lee Company kind of were the people who cashed in on this the most. But the city of Beaumont really was the one that would benefit it, because as this is the Depression, he really helped a lot of people make it through the Depression. They gave them jobs. They had programs going on that helped people make it. But anyway, Mr. Halbooty was kind of in on part of that. He is considered one of the, I guess, preeminent wildcatters today, one of those still alive today that was around. And as I mentioned, he's 91, but he is going to be one of the keynote speakers today. He's a great guy to talk to. Very entertaining, to say the least. Time for us to take a break. We're going to come back. We have a full slate of activities to get to. And, of course, don't forget the big event, the reenactment of Lucas number one blowing in shortly as we continue with our live coverage in Spindletop Celebration 2001.
Attention Beaumont and surrounding area. This is a public notice. Royal Furniture is conducting the biggest loss to lease sale in the history of the city. Everything must go. Start the new year right with the new furniture you've always wanted. After 30 years of serving Louisiana, our warehouses are full and we're liquidating all inventory through the new Beaumont store. No reasonable offer will be refused during Royal Furniture's public loss to lease liquidation sale. Everything must be sold. Living rooms, bedrooms, dining rooms, bedding, and dinettes. The selection is huge, so come to Royal Furniture today at 10 a.m.
As we join to celebrate Spindletop's glorious past, we're exploring its future. We are Centennial Oil and Gas Investments, and we hope to develop new oil and natural gas wells in the historic Spindletop Dome area. Early exploration relied greatly on determination and instinct. We now have generations of experience and technology to help us, methods like 3D seismic surveying through sound waves. Can Spindletop make history again? Centennial is working on it.
Dr. Singla and the physicians of Southeast Texas Laser Eye Institute can help you regain your sight starting as low as $9.99 per eye. LASIK correction has never been so affordable. Your first visit is free. Patients from around the country travel to Port Arthur to receive the best care available with the most advanced FDA lasers in the world. If poor sight has plagued you your entire life, make a commitment. Take advantage of this limited offer today. Throw away your glasses and see exactly what you've been missing. Call Southeast Texas Laser Eye Institute today. 1-877-40-LASIK.
This is Doug, president of Great Savings Auto Insurance. Why should you buy from me? How about zero down today? How about not taking your hard-earned money and sticking it all down on an auto policy? Stop wasting time. Stop overpaying. Stop calling competition. Stop spending your hard-earned paycheck on an auto policy. I've got 24-hour customer service, 24-hour claim service, zero down, $39 availability, $59 a month for full coverage. Pick up the phone and come over today at 835-RIDE and leave insured tonight.
You're watching KFD's special live coverage of the Spindletop 2001 Centennial Celebration. And now, back to the big day.
Hi, everyone. Dan Grimmer along with James Brown and a cast of thousands, literally, today.
No kidding.
As they will all be part of history in the making. This is the 100th on the centennial celebration for Spindletop 2001. You saw some of those pictures of the gushers, what they called side gushers, where they put the valves in and they'd shoot it sideways. Then what they would do a lot of times is if they had some what they thought was rolling money, which were people who were coming in the railroad, what they would do is they'd say, okay, shut the valve off. But when the train comes by, when I point at you, open the valve. So they'd get everybody on the train, all these investors, and as they're rolling by, they'd go, well, you know, if we just had your money, we think we could hit some more whales out here. And we're not sure, but we're pretty close then, with some of these
and
whales.
And then the signal would go, and then there she blows?
And then everybody would be reaching for their wallets to write their checks.
I want to invest.
Everybody wanted to be a part. In fact, the nickname was not Spindletop, but Swindletop, because there were so many swindles going on during that time. Busy morning here at Gladys City on the campus of Lamar University. We want to check in with Jackie Simmons. She's across the street over in the children's area. Good morning, Jackie.
Actually, Dan, I'm not far from you right now. I've moved back across the street. I'm right behind you where a lot of students are gathering right now. And it really is wonderful to see so many young people out here taking advantage of this time to be a part of history, because many Southeast Texas students have the day off today so they could be here at this program. And instead of staying home and watching it on TV, many of them have chosen to come out here with their fellow classmates, teachers, and families in some cases, so that they too can be a part of history and watch this in person. With me is a group of students who really did their homework, as you can see. They knew about the replica of the gusher, the reenactment taking place, and they came prepared. Please introduce yourselves and tell me what school you're from.
Hi, I'm Albert. I'm from Westbrook, and we are prepared with the ponchos.
I'm Pravin from Cathedral Christian School.
I'm Andrew from Cathedral.
And where did you get these great ponchos from? These are special Spindletop Centennial ponchos.
I think they were handing them out when you first get here, and it says something like the first some odd thousand or so get it, and so we came in early to celebrate Spindletop.
Wonderful. What did any of you know about Spindletop prior to all of the events leading up to today?
Did you know Lucas's wife was the one who told them to dig that extra 400 yards to get the oil?
What did you know before all the celebrations started taking place? Oh, I see one of them running away.
Just that this is the first, you know, oil, big oil, you know, spill thing in America, Beaumont, you know.
And really, there is no need for his friend to run away, because the purpose of today is so people can learn about the history. If you don't know about Spindletop, if you don't know about Captain Anthony Lucas, if you don't know about Patillo Higgins, that's what this is for. And we don't want to exclude children. There's a children's activity center where children can learn about some of the games that kids their age played back in 1901. They're giving children an opportunity to make their own butter, to take part in quilt making. There are horse and carriage rides across the street at the Children's Activity Center. So a great learning opportunity, a day off from school, but not a day off from learning. Dan?
All right, thank you very much, Jackie. We appreciate that. Boy, what a crowd. The crowd is building. I don't know if we can get a shot over our shoulders. You can kind of see the people
maybe
in there.
From the camera downstairs that we have. I mean, it's amazing to see all the crowd that is just flowing in and continuing to flow in from across the way, from Highland Avenue across the park there where the food court is and the crafts. All that is, boy, you talk about a packed house already here at Gladys City for the Spindletop celebration.
Now, I don't know about you, but I'm a little bit concerned about what happens when this derrick goes off behind us with this wind blowing the direction that it is. If it's 100 feet in the air, I have this feeling that while we may be strategic in our place, we may also be wet in this place by the time it's all over.
Well, you know, we were talking about east-southeasterly wind, and that's the case again today. And with the water shooting up in the air above that derrick, it's certainly going to get at least, we're going to be on the edge of it right here where we are. So we need to, do you have an umbrella? Did you bring your umbrella?
We have an umbrella. We should be okay. I think there's what? I think that what we're going to do here pretty shortly is we're going to go up onto the stage. Again, Larry Beaulieu is the master of ceremonies. I can see from the stage here that Tracy Byrd is up on the stage, I believe. I also see Mr. Hal Booty is up there, as we mentioned, who was one of the last great Wildcatters alive today, 91 years old. And he is right there, as a matter of fact, shaking hands. And I'm sure that the Secret Service folks are also clearing the way. Then we'll hear from former Mayor of Beaumont, Evelyn Lord, who, of course, is the committee chairperson. She is going to share some insight and some ideas about what happened and how this all came about. And I'm sure welcome all the people out this morning. And I would easily estimate we're well into the thousands, no doubt about that, for the number of people who are out here.
Whose big stretch limousine you think that is over there by the stage? No, I'm just joking. I know who's
the one with the police officer standing behind it, and the guys talking in their sleeves.
All the Secret Service people. President George Bush's limousine.
Would be his. Yeah, it's good to see a little bit of sun peeking through, but it's still cool out here this morning. If you're making your way out here, we said it all day long. Bundle up. I mean, do the layer. You know, where you do a couple of layers. If it does warm up, you can always take it off. But you, like James, you can't put gloves on if you don't have them. Right, James?
I've been offered gloves out here. Three different people have been kind enough. I said, you know, I'm doing fine because I have my pockets here. And
it's because he keeps his hands in his pocket.
Yeah, where I'm nice and warm.
That's why he's doing good. Yeah. And again, momentarily, we're going to go up onto the stage and join them for all the activities that are going on up there. We remind you, 10:32, a lot of people will say, why 10:32? What's the big deal about 10:32?
What is the big deal about 10:32?
That was the exact time that, as it was recorded, that it happened. All right, as you can hear the commotion, I believe that the former president of the United States,
George Bush, H.W. Bush,
is up on the stage and is greeting the various members on the showmobile. Mr. Beaulieu shaking hands with the former president, as you can see, along with Mayor Lord, our former Mayor Lord, Evelyn Lord.
Well, she's still your honor, yeah.
Yeah, I see the president of Lamar University is also, Jimmy Simmons, is up on the platform as well. I think they're flipping a coin to see who goes first. I'm not really sure. I'm just kidding. They have a well-worked-out schedule and a well-worked-out plan as to who will go. Now,
Brian Longcar got me $45,000 for my car wreck.
I got hurt in a car wreck, and he got me $50,000.
He got me $75,000. I'm attorney Brian Longcar. If you've been hurt in a car wreck, call me now.
He got me $95,000.
My check was for $60,000.
I've helped thousands get the money they deserve for their car wreck. So if you've been hurt in a car wreck, call me now, and maybe you can be the next to say,
Brian Longcar got me $160,000.
One call. That's all.
And Larry Beaulieu is on stage getting ready to bring in our keynote speaker, the former President George Bush. Let's go to Larry on stage live.
All right.
Jamie Cox with Sunco, Steve Broeker with Sunoco Houston, Penny Clark, an archivist, is joining us here today, Rick Roberts from Chevron Phillips, George Kirkland, the CEO of Chevron North America, Chevron Orange, Scott Sharp, Chevron Port Arthur, Dick Cuno, and Aaron Allen from Chevron Environmental Management. Thanks to Goodyear again for sponsoring the activities across the street, and Lou Perfetti is here. Rick Hager is here from Atrovina and president of the Texas Energy Museum. And Roger Ebert, of CEO of Motiva, joins us today, along with Mike Killian from Motiva. The CEO of Unocal Pipeline, Joe Munro. And Elfatakem Jerry Mata joins us today. The sun has come out, so you won't need your ponchos until the gusher goes off. But thanks to Hibernia Bank and Dan Hallmark, they brought us the 1,000 ponchos that are here today. And you got a wonderful ride on a bus over here from the parking centers, and that was courtesy of Community Bank and Bill McNinch. Calibran Chemical CEO Charles Colagandro is here. Dave Manamain also with Calibran Chemical. Beaumont Methanol is represented by Nick DeRuz today. And at this time, it is my distinct pleasure to introduce one of the busiest ladies the last 3 years, the former mayor of Beaumont, Evelyn Lord.
Welcome. You'd think we'd know better than to leave our papers on the podium. So, Larry Beaulieu, would you come back here for a minute and give me my notes? No. Thank you very much. We're going to be very much on time today, and as you may notice, we're getting a few minutes earlier so we can get some of the niceties out of the way, because 10:32 is a very important time. I don't know whether Larry explained to you, but if you see me stand up and stand beside a speaker, that means he's run over his time. And those of you who know me know I'm just the girl who can do it, but President Bush, I won't do it to you. I haven't got that kind of chutzpah. I want to take a thanks to Larry Beaulieu for keeping us on schedule. We're on live TV, and we're going to blow this gusher on time. And with everyone's cooperation, we shall. I do need to tell you that we don't want you coming up in front here taking pictures. You have to take them from the side because it will spoil the view for people, and this is your show. All of you out there, the thousands of volunteers we've had and the good people of Beaumont and Southeast Texas have done themselves proud, and we will not let it rain on your parade unless it's the gusher. Now, my introduction is going to be very limited, and we're very honored to have with us, and I'm not going to introduce the very special guest, he'll be introduced later, His Excellency Peter Moser, Ambassador to the United States of America from the Republic of Austria, which was, of course, the birthplace of Anthony Lucas. The ambassador, wave your hand, right, so they know who you are. And we have out in the audience Honorable Ottmar Colbert, Austrian consul in Houston, and Dr. Heinz Seitinger, who is the Austrian Trade Commissioner. With me on the platform is Mike Hal Booty, the legendary oil man and author of the book Spindletop. In the audience, representing U.S. Senator Kay Bailey Hutchison, Mary Schneider, and Al Davis, and representing U.S. Senator Phil Graham, Chris Devaney. Again on the platform, we have Tracy Byrd, RCA Country and Western star, and we also have his buddy, Britt Godwin. In the audience, I'm happy to tell you, we have with us today Mark Chestnut as well, sitting in the front row, and we're delighted about that. Representative Ron Lewis is with us, Texas State Senator and Commission Member Steve Ogden, Jefferson County Judge and South Spindletop Commissioner Carl Griffith, and the member of the State Railroad Commission, Charles Matthews. Very briefly, if you'll stand as I call your name, the commissioners who helped put us together, Lori Leister, Donald Boomans, Dr. Charles Bowman, Dr. Joseph Pratt, Dr. Roger Oliens, Victor Rogers, J. Linnea Yates, Janice Trammell, Cynthia Beeman, Janice Trammell, oh, she got mentioned twice. That's pretty good. Well, she's been pretty important. Ryan Smith, Robert Robinson, others that have been on the commission are Vic Saitis, Tony Garza, and, of course, we particularly want to thank Angela Baker, our executive director, and Paula Bothy of The Big Day, and Melissa Myers and Ruth Nomzek, who kept us on chart. Now, we'll go along, and we're going to add that Verna Rutherford is also with us. She's a member of the board of directors of Friends of Spindletop. Now, Dr. Jimmy Simmons, would you come forward, please, and welcome us to this occasion. Dr. Jimmy Simmons, a Spindletop commissioner and president of Lamar.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Evelyn. I want to take this opportunity to welcome all of our distinguished guests and each and every one of you to Lamar University on this historic day. It is such a thrilling sight to see all that has been done by these literally thousands of volunteers who have worked so hard and have given so much to make this day possible. We are very proud, and we feel that it is most appropriate that we are hosting this celebration on the Lamar University campus, a place dedicated to learning, to discovery, and to the future. 100 years ago, not far from this site, dedication to an idea and determination changed the course of history. Our schools, our colleges, our universities are changing the course of history one student at a time. Today, let us remember our heritage, the heritage of Spindletop, and celebrate our future. Thank you very much, and welcome to our campus.
And now I would like to ask Ambassador Peter Moser to say a few words and bring you greetings from the country of Austria. His Excellency Peter Moser.
Thank you, Mrs. Lord. When I was approached last year to take part in this celebration, I was very grateful. First of all, it's a good excuse for an ambassador to leave Washington, D.C. and to join the life of true Americans. And second of all, I'm very grateful that I can take part in this ceremony because of Mr. Lucas, who gave his name to this gusher. He's a fine specimen. He was a fine specimen of Austrian education and Austrian engineering. We have 150 years tradition in mining and in petrochemical. And when he was here, I'm happy to say that he could help you to find the right spot to hit oil. And now, after 100 years, I am particularly happy and grateful that Texas has not forgotten this Mr. Lucas. So I, basically a diplomat and a lawyer, I'm here to acknowledge the achievements of an engineer. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Everybody's behaving themselves so well, that gusher might be ready to blow a 1022, but we won't let that happen because we know a lot of people have timed. I noticed that I was waiting for to see him, and I believe he's arrived. Congressman Nick Lampson is also with us. We left out the names of all these lovely wives and husbands that are along with these big, important people. Because we thought we wouldn't have enough time to throw them all in, but we're doing very, very well, and that's good news. Now, I think that we're now going to hear from somebody that you've been waiting to hear for, and really you've all, I hope, read the book Spindletop, and Mr. Hal Booty is quite famous, and indeed he is here with us today, and he is the legendary oil man, and he'll tell you how old he is and about all those things you need to know. Mike Hal Booty, would you come and have your moment? Thank you.
Greetings. This is a very auspicious day. 100 years ago, on the 10th day of January, this day, on a Wednesday, and today is Wednesday, exactly 100 years ago, Spindletop blew in, and the impact on the world was tremendous. But more so, the lifestyle of Beaumont's 8,500 residents was disrupted in pandemonium reign. Let's see what happened to all the people in Beaumont. The boom began immediately. The lure of the big gusher was magnetic. People poured into the small town and took up every available and made up space. Hundreds walked the streets when they found no place to sleep. Everywhere there was a sort of insanity. It was a curious, carefree, oil-mad band of fortune hunters. Every man was a boomer. There were no strangers. The carnival spirit prevailed. It was like the stock market during a crisis, a battlefield during an attack, and a faro game where the fortune was made or lost on the turn of a single card. There was no ghost walk or mere spectacular show. It was real. Deals involving millions of dollars were as common as popcorn sales at a fair. Every walk of life was representative. Every state and almost every land on the globe had a delegate. On the registers of Beaumont hotels were senators and governors and cabinet members. There were names that were legendary to the average small town Texan. names like William Jennings Bryan, George J. Gould, John W. Gates, Andrew Carnegie, and the Rockefellers. The Crosby House became a center of this madness, where men gathered day and night. The bar and the cafe became 24-hour operations, along with the remainder of the hotel. It was time for most of the traders chose to assemble. They would stand on tables and chairs and offer to buy land or leases, which were traded without benefit of clear title or even guaranteed ownership, and then would be sold and resold on the same basis. The sales were made solely. The young and the old mingled and mixed. They spoke of oil and dollars and land. Most of them had no knowledge of the subject they were discussing, but they were on the ground floor, and that was all that mattered. They were on the spot that the whole world was talking and reading about, and they wanted to be a part of the historical event. This was Beaumont, the home of Spindletop, from January the 10th, 1901, until no man knew when. The guys of all, better known as the Gusher, blessed America with the supply of energy and the incentive to move from a secondary position in world affairs to that of undisputed leadership. The great Gusher heralded a new industry, born amidst the most magnificent boom ever experienced. It accelerated the Industrial Revolution, which was at a standstill. It opened the era of mass production and untold comforts and conveniences. The entire world benefited from the phenomena of Spindletop. So it is proper that we pause a moment on this centennial day of discovery and reflect on the blessing of Spindletop conveyed on the world's people. Now, ladies and gentlemen, it gives me great, great pleasure to introduce to you the 41st President of the United States, George Herbert Walker Bush.
I give him a new hip work.
Yeah, no.
Yeah, pal. Great being with you.
Thank you all very much. And let me just say, it's a great pleasure to be here this day. Somebody said, how come you're going to Beaumont? And I said, have you ever tried to say no to Evelyn Lord? It's impossible. Then you throw in Halibuti, we got a problem, but I'm glad to be here, thrilled to be here, delighted to see Ambassador Moser of one of our great friends, Austria, here today, coming down from Washington to honor this great occasion. I'm pleased to see Dr. Simmons, who not only has made available this campus, but does such a wonderful job in the education of the youth of our great state. And delighted to be here with him. And of course, Tracy Byrd. I'm gonna finish. I was gonna give you about 45 minutes on the Federal Reserve Board, but I want to hear him, so we're not gonna do that. Besides that, Evelyn is tough. She said 7.5 minutes and get out. Okay, Evelyn, thank you. I'm glad to see the congressman here, Nick Lampson, and many other representatives of state government, Beaumont officials, officials from other cities. It is tough following Mike Halibuti, particularly on an occasion like this, when the subject is the oil industry, be it in Texas or worldwide. I can't think of any individual that knows nor about it nor has contributed more to it than Mike Halibuti. He is remarkably accomplished, profoundly respected man in the field, and Barbara and I consider him a very dear family friend. I know that we have students. I've met some of them a minute ago, of all ages today, here. And for the record, despite a few gray hairs, neither Mike Halabuti nor I was here when Spindletop came in. Although he gets a little closer than I do, but not a hell of a lot, actually. Michael has written more about the defining moment than most people could possibly ever know.